Good morning, everyone. Feels very odd to be presenting from my living room instead of seeing your lovely faces, but thank you very much for joining today. Very excited to be here at DevConf. I'm Liz. We'll be presenting about machine learning and how it's adding new possibilities to the world of user experience today. So first of all, good question is probably, who am I? Just to give you a little bit of background. So I'm the practice lead for UX and UI design at DBT. I have master's in information design. I'm currently busy with a PhD. In other words, I'm a bit of a masochist who likes to do research. I play violin in an 1800s cover band. In other words, an orchestra, because if you think about it, that's all we do. It's cover songs from the 1800s. And I love adventure. So I love traveling. I've climbed Kilimanjaro. Sadly, traveling does not seem like it will be on the cards anytime soon with our current lockdown. Traveling from the living room to the bedroom to the study. So that's the extent of my traveling at the moment. So when you first hear the words UX and machine learning, you start thinking, but what do these things actually have to do with one another? So first of all, let's look at UX, just so that we all have the same understanding of what UX is. So UX and UI sometimes get confused. UX is user experience design. It's how something looks and feels. It's the behind the scenes structure. And the user interface is how something looks. So if you have bad UX, you have this. This is Microsoft Word with absolutely all of the toolbars enabled. Kind of usable. You can type one line at a time, but it's going to be painful as all hell to actually get anything done. Now, if you have bad UI, on the other hand, it can be confusing and counterintuitive because we're used to seeing stop as red and start as green. So I'm very sure on this interface, people have clicked on the wrong things many times. And I don't know if any of you have ever seen lingscars.com. It's one of my favorite sites. It is confusing as all hell. Completely overwhelming. You can argue that it's a very bad UI, but it's very entertaining. And they actually have a very good user experience once you start looking at buying their cars or renting their cars, at least. And yes, Ling is lovely. So machine learning. What is machine learning? So machine learning was actually already coined the term in 1958 by Arthur Samuel, a computer scientist. And he said that machine learning is a field of study that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. So this is not a new concept, machine learning, but the way that it's being applied is becoming a lot more sophisticated. The other thing that machine learning is a buzzword. And everyone loves saying machine learning about everything because everyone wants a machine learning, right? So now we get to the question, what does UX actually have to do with machine learning? So when you think of machine learning, you think of algorithms and you think of processing things. You don't think of experiences necessarily. Now, there's a whole long list of things that I've identified, which I'll take you through today, show you some examples. And just to preempt, I do have a lot of examples from Google. I'm not punting Google. They just happen to be working on some really cool things. So something that machine learning is very good at is identifying anomalies. This is because it's good at finding patterns. So an anomaly to that pattern is easily identifiable. This is already being used in things like fraud detection in banks, where you can very quickly notice that if you're in South Africa and you've always lived in South Africa and you suddenly get a transaction from Slovakia, something might be off. Instagram is using this anomaly detection and NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, and neuro-linguistic understanding in order to detect bullying language. So according to them, if you post something like, you are so ugly and stupid, it'll flag it and it'll ask you, are you sure you want to post this? Let's keep Instagram a supportive place. So I must admit, I tried this last night, just for interest's sake. And I had to very quickly explain to my boyfriend that, no, I did not in fact think he was ugly and stupid. I had to needed his help to delete the comment from his Instagram. So it's a great idea. I'm not sure if it's implemented. And I'd advise don't go and try that unless you really know the person and you know you can very quickly explain the situation to them. Twitter is also using this kind of NLP detection and sentiment analysis to detect hate speech and to flag those kinds of tweets. In this case, it was specifically looking at religious hate speech and trying to avoid that and trying to keep Twitter a friendlier, happier place. Not that it necessarily is, but they are working towards that, which is great. So another thing that machine learning is also allowing us to do in user experience is it's creating new ways to interact. Things like chatbots, which then use NLP and NLU. This is from an example, Hipmunk on Facebook. They're a travel agency in America. You can type a sentence to them. The blue is what I typed. And it picks up on the specific words that you are looking for, and then it answers it because it can understand the context. And it's a really interesting way that it's becoming more natural to interact. Another example that I'm sure a lot of you have seen and used, things like Google Home, Siri, Alexa, you can ask it questions and it responds to that. Now, this becomes a bit tricky with invisible interfaces because it can very easily get it wrong and it's not very clear what options are actually available. I'm sure many of you have gotten this where you ask Siri something and it just tells you, sorry, I can't do that, or I don't understand that. Or this example from Google Home or Google Assistant where it says, I can let you know if you need a jacket today. You say, do I? Sorry, I don't understand, because it doesn't understand the context. So while these kinds of interfaces are really interesting and have a lot of potential, they still have some ways to go. Computer vision is another one where it's really adding a lot of benefits and use. And it's allowing things to be identified that would normally be very difficult for people that have accessibility issues to actually gain access to. Now, again, it has a high potential for getting things wrong. So don't trust it. Don't just trust it blindly. It might tell you that your cat's a dog. But it is very useful for things where there weren't things before. For instance, on Facebook, if you activate this option, it gives accessibility tools for the visually impaired. So it can actually describe what is in an image. So it makes it a lot easier for people that have certain impairments to be able to understand that this image may contain tree, sky, outdoor, where normally they just would have no idea what is on the image. Now, I attended an online conference on Monday and Tuesday. It was streamed from Copenhagen, and they had live captioning enabled for the speakers. It did not go down well. As you can see from these examples, the live captioning got it horribly wrong. I think it changed Microsoft Surface Pro to Vegetable Surface Pro. There is thanking people for bananas. The favorite one, which I didn't manage to capture, was, and next, tuna, Laura, trying to introduce a speaker. So again, a lot of space that still needs to be improved, but it's already helping quite a lot. We are also in a space where we can use things like selfies to activate banking accounts that FNB, this is a campaign that FNB has been running from last year. We can actually open a bank account by snapping a selfie, checks your face against your home affairs record, and it's just making interactions a bit easier. Google Photos and most of the other things, I know iPhone does it as well, it starts grouping photos together based on themes or content and people. It makes it a lot easier to search and filter. This is a really interesting one. Google developed a thing called the Google Clips camera. It's a machine learning camera that you clip anywhere in your house. And the thinking behind it was, especially with pets and kids, you often don't get that perfect photo that you would want. And you also don't necessarily want to be taking photos the whole time while you're having interactions. So you clip it somewhere and it detects what it thinks the best photo is. So it will check the composition, the lighting, contrast, things like that, and then take photos when it thinks it's appropriate. And it's a very interesting thought. Has the potential to be very creepy. Again, a lot of these things can be used for very nefarious purposes, but it's an interesting idea as well. Google Lens, very cool thing that helps you identify things as you see them. This is a beautiful little labradoodle, and you can use it for identifying artworks, landscapes, anything like that. Now, the part of machine learning and UX that I start getting very excited about is hyper-personalization. It allows you to personalize experiences because in the end, no one wants something that's just built for the masses and thrown at them. You want something that's curated for you and created for you, and that's what makes a good experience. So machine learning, with the way that it works, is helping us to do that. So one of the most obvious examples, I'm sure most of you have seen this, With YouTube Music, Spotify, all of that, it curates playlists that it thinks is appropriate to you. Netflix, again, very good example, giving you recommendations. So based on other things that you've watched, it'll give you examples. Now, they go a bit further. They start customizing the actual thumbnails that you see. So if you've watched Pulp Fiction, you'll know that it has Uma Thurman and John Travolta. So if you've watched a lot of movies with Uma Thurman in it, when it suggests Pulp Fiction to you, it'll show Uma Thurman as the thumbnail. Whereas if you've watched a lot of films with John Travolta, it'll show John Travolta as the thumbnail. Small thing, but then they take it another step further. By the way, they post all of these things on their blog on Medium. Definitely go and check it out. It's really fascinating. So for Stranger Things, for instance, they started analyzing the different themes that were in the story. Friendship, sci-fi, horror, romance, and they started creating thumbnails based on that and started serving that to people based on what they thought would attract that person into the series. Now, they use something called contextual bandits in order to do this. It's an online learning algorithm. Now, bear with me, I am not a developer, and if I do screw up this explanation, I apologize completely, but do go and check it out. The whole idea is that normally you would come up with two different solutions and you would A/B test it. So A being the current production experience and B is the new algorithm that they've implemented. And then based on that, they would very quickly be able to see what is actually working and be able to, I can't find the right term now, they'd be able to lose a lot of regret in terms of not wasting too much time A/B testing before they roll out what they think is most appropriate for you. They also did this with profile types and seeing what kind of artwork you would resonate best with. So for Good Will Hunting, they realized that some people might like comedy more, others might like romance more. So if you watched a lot of romantic comedies, they would show you a photo of the couple being intimate or kissing. And if you're more likely to watch comedy, they'll show you a photo with Robin Williams, which will hopefully in their minds make you watch it easier. Now, personalization can go very wrong very quickly. So I'd like to tell you a story about Target, first of all. Now, Target has been using statisticians to create algorithms for quite a while in order to help them figure out what is the best way to target customers. Now, they had a statistician called Andrew Pohl, who worked for them, who tried to figure out, but what is the best way that we can market things to people? And somehow he managed to work out that if a woman bought a tub of cocoa butter, a bag large enough to double as a diaper bag, zinc and magnesium supplements, and for some reason, a large blue bag, there was an 87% chance that this woman was pregnant. And he was able to determine what semester of her, or trimester of her pregnancy she was in, which I think you can see already has the potential to be a bit odd, but okay. Enter the angry father. So this man phoned Target, and he's like, listen, you sent coupons to my teenage daughter saying that she can get all of these discounts on pregnancy things. And for diapers and for supplements, et cetera, and my daughter is 16 years old. What are you trying to say? Are you trying to encourage teenage pregnancy? How dare you do this? And this became quite a big thing, and Target came back and they were horrified, and they said, we are so sorry, we're just trying to give coupons to our customers that we think might be useful for them. And it was this big thing, and then 2 days later the dad came back and he's like, so I kind of have to apologize, seems there have been things going on in my house that I was unaware of. My daughter is in fact pregnant. Now, you can kind of see how this has the potential to really creep people out. And Target really quickly realized that people got very upset when Target knew they were pregnant before they did, or very shortly after they found out. And the way that they sort of found a way around this was to hide their pregnancy coupons in between other things. So if they gave you a coupon for diapers and for children's clothes or whatever, they would hide it in between other coupons for gardening gear and TVs, etc., because people were more likely to use the coupons if they didn't feel like they were being spied on, which is fair. No one likes having their privacy invaded. Facebook. So I'm sure everyone has feelings about Facebook, good or bad, whatever it might be. A feature they brought out a few years ago was urine review. So a really interesting idea. They show you all the things that have been happening the past year. And you can relive all your travels that you had, all your friends that you saw. And then one day, there's a man called, Eric Meyer. He received this photo on Christmas Eve, 24th of December, of his beautiful little six-year-old daughter. And he looked at it and he had a breakdown because his beautiful little daughter, the reason why that photo had been his most liked and most commented on photo was because his six-year-old daughter had died of cancer earlier that year after a 10-month struggle with the disease. That's not exactly something that you want to highlight for someone. And he wrote a whole blog about it. This was in 2014. And it was really, really tragic because his words were, it's inadvertent algorithmic cruelty. Such an odd phrase, but when you think about it, the algorithm wasn't trying to upset him. It just went, oh, this is your most liked photo. Let's show it to you. And the sad thing is that's happened to a lot of other people as well. These were just a few examples that I found. Someone's photo of their house burning down. Someone's dad's ashes being shown. Me too. 20 years today, time still flies, still thinking of your dad, rest in peace. These are not exactly the things that you want to show to someone with streamers and happy music behind it. And Facebook didn't quite think through the way that this algorithm would work. They just figured, oh, most liked post, we'll go with that. So it's important to be very aware of how things can be used and can be interpreted accidentally. Now, on a slightly lighter note, my own experience with Facebook for targeted ads. A few years ago, I was in a 3-year relationship, which was Facebook official, the works, you know, as one should do, you know, properly. And I started getting ads for engagement rings because, you know, 3 years, obviously, never mind that I was 21. And then when I was single, these are actual screenshots of the ads Facebook started to show me. And I just start thinking like, damn, Facebook, you should have some chill. It's not necessary to remind me that I'm going to die old and alone with my cat. And while I'm very sure, or I hope, that there was no malicious intent behind these, it's still something that should maybe just be considered, how things might be interpreted. Not everyone conforms to the way that you are building this algorithm. And maybe just think of the outliers that might be just a little bit iffy about what's going on. So another thing that machine learning does very well is it's creating new tools to actually assist in the design process. So this is a Google Draw, an AI experiment that they created. So you draw something similar to something, and it gives you options of icons that you can then refer to that. And I don't know how much this will help me because I can't draw, but it's a very interesting idea that it recognizes it and gives you options for what that icon could then actually be. For Netflix, again, they have an automated translation process where you can tell, because they're available in so many different languages, it's not necessarily possible to always make titles for all of the different shows in all of the different languages. So for Orange is the New Black, for instance, you just tell it what text needs to be in there, more or less the space and what the original one is. And it gives you lots of different options for the different languages. Someone who then obviously needs to be able to speak the language can then just go, yes, no, yes, yes, no, instead of having to manually fix the typography for every single one. It's something that really is just speeding up the process. And then we get to this, which is really fascinating. A few years ago, there was a movie came out called Morgan. And they actually asked IBM Watson, which is IBM's AI, to create a trailer for it. And here we go.
It's first birthday. Exceeds our wildest expectations.
Nice to meet you, Morgan. Nice to meet you, thanks. I have a 13-year-old daughter. You don't get to see her much anymore. Skip, don't go in there, okay?
Don't, what?
Don't you go down there, Skip! Don't be afraid, Amy. I have to go say goodbye to Mother.
Fox approached IBM and they said, well, we have this movie coming out. It's called Morgan. And it's an AI horror thriller. And then what Fox asked was, could Watson analyze the movie and generate a trailer automatically?
As human beings, we're very quick to judge the mood of an individual. Possibly an AI over time might be able to develop those same instincts.
So we thought, let's send Watson to film school.
Morgan was our little breakthrough. It exceeds our wildest expectations.
Here you have the whole of the Morgan movie, and you can see where action is taking place at the different moments of the movie. And this is how Watson actually extracted salient moments from Morgan, which we then proposed for making the trailer.
Watson was able to model the scenes visually to determine, was the scene scary? Was it a tender moment? Was there sadness or happiness?
Watson is the tool that's helping arrange the visuals, but it still needs the human element. So then I can come in and just supervise the creative aspect of it.
I don't think AI is any value until it does start to understand and calibrate those emotions for itself.
I think that's asking a deeper question. Will computers be able to create art? Can they create a period? It's still very difficult to think of how a computer might be capable of original thought, something that's essential in creativity.
So that raises quite a few interesting questions. And as you can hear, they say that Watson arranged the visuals, but it did still need a bit of human intervention in tweaking the visuals and the audio. But it was at a really interesting start, and it's a way to help the producers and the editors to actually put this together to see, but how would a machine, or machine learning at least, an algorithm, put these things together? Screen we're on now. Sorry, I should have kept it on the other one because this is slightly distracting. This is not user experience. I just found this fascinating. You can actually, in Autodesk, add in specific dimensions. So this is the body for a drone, and you can add in, so what should the weight be? What should the weight bearing capacity be? What material should it be? And it just starts generating different iterations of it, and that you can then 3D print and then see what works for you. And I just found it so fascinating that it's helping with that iterative process so that we don't necessarily need to manually go through that. Adobe. I'm sure many of you have worked with Adobe, and whether you love or hate Photoshop, it is one of the things that still forms a very big part of our world. Adobe has their own AI that they call Adobe Sensei. It is used in all of the programs listed here and a lot more. These are just a few of the examples that I pulled. And in Photoshop especially, there are a lot of things that use machine learning that I never even realized. Things like content aware fill, face aware liquify, auto selection, etc. And I have a quick video here again to show how they came about.
Hi, I'm Meredith Dotsner from the Photoshop team. Here's a sneak of an Adobe Sensei powered feature we've been working on for an upcoming release of Photoshop CC. Making selections in Photoshop is an important part of image editing. We're developing a feature to help you get started with your selections faster and easier than ever before. It's called Select Subject, and it's using machine learning to detect objects in the image. Often we start with basic selections before refining the edges. There are multiple ways to get that starting selection. Each takes some level of effort. In today's Photoshop, you might use the Quick Select tool and its edge detection technology. You could try selecting the negative space with the magic wand or Quick Select. Many users prefer to use the pen tool. You might go with outlining with the lasso or the magnetic lasso tools. They're all great options. But what if you could get that starting selection with just one click? Select Subject lets you do just that. Let's look at an example with multiple subjects. Still, just one click to get a great start. Complicated details around the subject aren't an issue because this feature is using machine learning to recognize the objects. Select Subject is also available in the Select and Mask workspace, so you can refine the mask edge for a professional finish all in one spot. This new feature is designed to simplify workflows for our Creative Cloud members, and it's coming in an update to Adobe Photoshop CC.
So that is something that actually came out a few years ago already. And for those of you that have ever tried to deep etch a foreground subject from the background, it is painful. And for something like machine learning to be able to help us in image editing or in any sort of editing, it really makes life just so much quicker and easier, because that's a slightly monotonous, mindless task that in an ideal world, we wouldn't have to sit and struggle with. Something else that machine learning is definitely helpful with and that I've done myself is persona creation. I don't know how many of you have experienced this before, but in user experience design, we often try and create personas for the people we're designing for. So you create a fictional character and say, Mary has these specific personality traits, and this is how she would react if she wanted to buy a new car, for instance. Now, we actually went and we worked with a data science team at our client, which I can't quite discuss for privacy reasons, so all the blurred things, but you get the idea. They started mapping all of the different customers that we had and started seeing what groupings arose from this. So these are different kinds of people that sort of have more or less the same behaviors and traits. So from this, we were able to then identify where they overlap and where we should be spending most of our time and energy. We could see who were the customers that were costing us the most and who were spending the most money. So where would it be the most valuable for us to actually focus our attention in order to save the company money? So this was very important for business. And from this, we were then able to create little grandpa characters, our different personas for the different clusters that we were able to identify. So this really helped that we weren't making up and say, oh, John, we think John 85 lives there and has more or less these things. We could actually see from the data that 5% of the people we were looking at had exactly the same following traits, and they were more or less in this group. Sorry for being so vague. I can't really go into more detail, but it really helps us to just get an idea of real people and what we could really help them with. Now, machine learning and ethics. I'm sure many of you have heard this many times. It's something that is very important and that people don't necessarily pay enough attention to, because along with machine learning comes data mining. And an important thing is transparency, is understanding that allowing people to understand that we're learning from your data and we're making recommendations. On Facebook, for instance, if you see sponsored ads, you can ask, why am I seeing this? And it will tell you that, the following client wanted to know the following, and we thought that it would be appropriate to you. Small things like that just help to tell people, give them transparency and help them to understand how you are actually using their data. Now, I'm sure some of you have watched the documentary, The Great Hack, about Cambridge Analytica and Facebook. So Professor David Carroll, not Carol Davis, this man here, he was actually the person to sue Cambridge Analytica for his data. He started realizing what they were doing, and he brought a case against them in the UK, where you are allowed to actually ask a company for all of the data that they have collected on you. So he's in America, but he brought the case in the UK because that's the only place he could. Long story short, he won the court case, I think 3 years ago. To date, he still has not seen a single piece of the data that they collected on him. They had to pay numerous fines to him because of this. He still hasn't seen his data. And that's the terrifying thing. We know how much data we post online, and I'm sure many of you know that a lot of companies collect a lot of data on you above and beyond what you willingly give. We don't know what they have. We don't know what they're doing with it. We don't know who they're giving it to. And that starts becoming a bit scary and concerning when you start realizing what people can use it for. For instance, for those of you who don't know, Cambridge Analytica has been implicated in actually skewing the US election results in 2016 because they were targeting ads to people with specific political backgrounds or political views to try and change them. So I live close to an Air Force base, so apparently they've decided to start running drills. So an important thing with an AI is you need to make it very clear to people that if they're talking to a bot, trust is very important. You don't want to try and fool people. This very cool little app called Lemonade. It's for building insurance in the US. It's a bot you're chatting to, Maya. Maya's not a real person. I don't know why Maya has a photo, because she's not a real person. Then it's important to avoid the uncanny valley. I don't know who of you know of the uncanny valley or what it is. Usually at this point I would ask, and I'm going to guess some of you put up your hands that you don't know what it is, because I don't know. So the uncanny valley is what happens when, as things become more human, they become more familiar. We're talking in terms of robots and robotic things that become more human-like, up into a point where it gets really, really creepy. So as an example, a humanoid robot like C-3PO, our favorite, kind of humanoid, kind of human-like, but not trying to be human. So he's very likable and really friendly and really engaging. Don't know who of you have seen the movie Cats or heard of it. That starts becoming really creepy because you have CG people transposed into cat bodies, and something about it is off. And it's because it falls into that uncanny valley where it's human-like, but not quite, and it's just weird. And something like this, whatever this is, it's also really, really creepy because it's human-like to the point where it's close, but not quite. And it's just, there's something off-putting and scary about it. So you never want to go into the uncanny valley. You want to make it either, and we are not at the point where machine learning or AIs are human. So don't try and fool people. Be upfront, be honest. That is what makes them approachable. So if you're talking to a bot, you want to be able to trust it, and we want to keep trying to enforce that. This is something that I worked on a while ago for Liberty. Right from the beginning, we tell you are talking to a short-term chatbot, and it's like, hi, I am the Liberty short-term chatbot. And make it very clear, we also used a illustration instead of a photo to again reinforce that idea that this is a bot that you're talking to. And you'll see at the bottom right-hand corner there, it says talk to a person. So we make it very easy for you to break out to the call center if you suddenly start becoming frustrated with this bot. Because we know that bots have issues and they don't always understand you. And you don't ever want someone stuck in a loop where they're just frustrated and annoyed and delete your app. So machine learning, the learning part's kind of important. So you want to allow for the algorithm to keep learning. So this is on, if you download the Google app, it will surface things from time to time, and it will ask you, is this useful right now or not? You can say yes or no, and from there it updates your feed and it learns what your kind of preferences are. Also, you can report Google predictions in the search. So for instance, if it tells you is the earth flat or round or flat proof, then you can predict the ones that you think are right or not. And I'm not going to get into that debate right now, but report the ones that you think are inappropriate because they should not be surfacing. So people then start asking, but machine learning is developing so rapidly, and machine learning, it's doing such cool, great things. Is it going to replace designers, or is it going to replace developers? At what point are we going to become obsolete? And for that, I will show you this video quickly.
Your website is your own corner of the internet, a place to call home. For your business, your portfolio, your hobby, your own space to say what you want to say. There are plenty of ways to get a website, but a template isn't for you. A Facebook page isn't for you. Your site should reflect who you are, and it should look good doing it. Sure, you could build one yourself, but designing, developing, dragging and dropping, these are all full-time jobs. Wouldn't it be better if you could just do what you care about and have all that other stuff just happen? Wouldn't it be better if websites just made themselves? Now they do. It's called the grid. No templates, no coding, no walled gardens. Just tell the grid what you want, and it uses artificial intelligence to build a tailor-made home for your content. Need your site to look professional? Done. Or maybe it should look a little more casual. Easy. Then tell the grid what you want to do. Looking for more customers, more followers, higher sales? Just make your selection, and your site will be optimized for that purpose. Need more content? Capture and post anything from anywhere on the web with a single click. And here's the thing. Your site will evolve as you add more to it. The layout adapts to your content. Images are cropped and color corrected for maximum impact. The design adjusts to look good on every browser and every device, automatically. It's as easy as that. Actually, it's incredibly complicated, but the grid figures it out so you don't have to. And when each of us has our own corner of the web, a space that is uniquely ours, that's the start of a more beautiful internet. Content is power. Power your content on the grid.
Who of you are feeling inspired right now? Who of you are feeling scared right now? I would love to actually hear, like, please post on the Slack channel. Who of you have actually ever heard of the grid? I'm genuinely interested. So this video is from 2013, so 7 years ago. They're currently on their third iteration. And the reason why we all still have jobs is I went and looked up some of these amazing things that the grid designed. Let me show you some examples. So we have this lovely page. That top half, that is the header. That stays there the entire time, no matter what you do. Next example, love it. It's just design, you know, how could any designer or dev do better? Again, like it's a work of art. I'm being sarcastic in case it isn't clear. Another lovely example. Oh, it gets better. We have this. And then I think this is my absolute favorite. If you look right in the middle there, the thing that's supposed to be a button, it says, awesome web design. I mean, how can I ever aspire to be better than this? So when after the grid came out, the sort of universal agreement was, this is absolutely horrifically bad. I genuinely tried to look for good reviews. I couldn't find a single one. So even just from a development point of view, this was on Reddit, if you thought it was bad after looking at the websites, try looking at the source code. 150 plus different media queries, all in the CSS, dumped in the head of the page. I have no words. So it's not even that the design wasn't amazing. The actual code that it was generating was painful. So the agreement was sort of just like, yeah, it's fine. I think we're keeping our jobs for now. So in short, no, I do not think that machine learning will be replacing designers or dev, at least not anytime soon. What it comes down to is that humans, UX designers, developers, all of us, we have empathy and machines don't yet. That is something that is a very far ways off if we ever get there. And it's important to understand that if you think of all the examples that I've shown you, machine learning is being used as a tool. It's being used as a way to make people's lives easier, to create new solutions, etc. But human intervention is necessary in order to push it just that step further, because we can make critical decisions on what we are doing, whereas the machine just goes, meh. So in closing, Machine learning algorithms still can't determine the difference between a blueberry muffin and a chihuahua. So I genuinely think we're safe, just for now. And that's it. Thank you so much for listening. Please, questions from anyone, I'd be happy to answer. I like questions, love answering questions. You're also welcome to find me on the DevConf Slack or find me on Twitter. And then please remember to rate the different talks, all of the speakers' talks. You guys that are rating can win. From what I understand from Robert, it is a notebook that you write in, and then you can digitally scan it and get all your notes on your digital devices. And when it's full, you simply microwave it, make it empty again, and then you get things back, or then you can start writing again. No questions? Anyone? On the stream, you click the little question mark, and then you can send things on there. No. Wait, let me check Slack quickly. So yes, I really enjoy machine learning for the simple fact that there are so many things on there that are making our lives easier and that are allowing us as designers to further our craft. So as I said, I'm not a developer, but I do genuinely think that there are so many tools that we can utilize and use. Okay, let me see. Okay, I'm reading Slack, so bear with me quickly. Does the grid allow for human intervention? So I have never played with the grid itself yet. The original one was offline. Go and check them out, Google them. I think it's thegrid.io. I think they're on their third iteration now. So one of the big things with them was they asked for investors to send them things beforehand, to send them money before they launched the product. So as I said, this was in 2013. So I think it was a bit before or just about when, Kickstarter and all of those things started going. So they got a lot of money and investors were really angry with what they got back. As far as I understand, the grid does allow for human intervention, but very little. You can literally, you can choose from settings on a list. You can't actually code anything. It asks you, do you want to use the site for primarily? Is it marketing or is it photography or whatever? And you select options. You can't actually design or code anything itself. Yourself, it generates that for you. Let's see. Will we be guiding the AI in the future, or will it be devalued in the eyes of our employers? I think that artificial intelligence and sorry for all the messages coming through on Slack. I definitely think that we will be guiding the direction that artificial intelligence is going in, and I do think that it has a lot of value. As I showed from those examples, there are a lot of things that are already happening and that will still be happening, and things are still being tweaked and refined as they go along. A lot of them have quite a ways to go. People love saying that, oh no, robots are going to take over the world and, you know, Skynet and I don't know what else, but we're nowhere near that. I have a few friends that work in the area of neural networks and NLP and NLU, and they, when people start saying that, they sort of just go like, they can't even get their things to recognize basic objects. Like, it's very far from actually gaining empathy and taking over the world, or losing empathy, if I can even say that. I definitely think that it will be used a lot more going forward as more and more people understand where it can be used and understand that it's not just something on the fringe edge that, you know, cutting edge scientists are working on. It's already in Photoshop. It's already in a lot of the things that we use on a daily basis. We just don't think about it as artificial intelligence or machine learning that we are using. Edward is saying that Google and Facebook is Skynet. Yeah, probably yes. I don't know if any of you saw, they have suggested that with this current coronavirus outbreak, our government in South Africa want to gain access to all of the cell phone networks so that they can track where every single person is and has been, so that they can identify if someone has been infected, who that person was in contact with. Okay, interesting way of trying to combat the virus. Massive potentials for abuse and misuse after this virus has ended. So people will always try and find ways to survey or get mass surveillance of the people. I see there are some more questions here. If I can access them. So many tabs open. Okay, any other questions on Slack? Okay, I see people saying that they haven't heard about the grid. Go and check it out. It's a very interesting thought. I don't know in practice how effective that will ever be, especially since it doesn't allow for much human interaction. There are lots of things like Wix, etc., that do allow you sort of templatized views that you can use, and that can help you to design websites where you can actually edit things and give your own input. Kavishan shared the user interface. I actually took that slide out because I was worried I was going to run out of time. Please go and check it out. It's called User Interface. It is the most frustrating UX experience that you will ever try and do. All you have to do is fill in a form. And I haven't been able to finish that thing. I rage quit every single time. And they intentionally try to make it as frustrating as possible. In order to create a password, it asks you for Cyrillian characters and I think a picture of your mother or I don't even know what. I think the shortest time I've heard of was someone doing it in 7 minutes and they almost broke their computer after that. But yes, it's very funny. Any more questions? Anyone? Yes? No? Okay. I think let's end it there. Feel free to find me on the Slack. DevConf, remember to go and rate. Wait, someone asked me to go back, yes, to this slide. There are quite a few examples of this. There are photos of where machine learning algorithms can't identify between lots of different things. This is just the one that I know of. No, there's one about Labradors and chocolates and I don't know what else, but it's hilarious. You would think that it's something so simple when actually it becomes quite complicated very easily. Okay, great. Thank you so much, guys. Have a lovely day further and enjoy the rest of your quarantine. Bye.